good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Institute of World Politics. We're very glad you could join us for Ben Fricke's lecture on Europe's hypocrisy and the migrant crisis. It doesn't look like IWP needs too much introduction. It is a bit like Old Home Week in here right now. But for those of you who aren't aware, the Institute of World Politics is a graduate school of national security and international affairs. We're dedicated to teaching all the instruments of statecraft and integrating them in a strategically coherent and ethical fashion. And Ben Fricke, we're proud to say, is one of our alumni. He graduated from IWP in the class of 2013 with a degree in statecraft and international affairs. His Bachelor of Arts in Political Science is from Wittenberg University in Springfield, Ohio. Perhaps not coincidentally, he is also from Wittenberg, Germany, where he has lived since his graduation from IWP. He's worked in private sector energy management and software, and we're very glad to welcome him back for this lecture on the Intermarium, sponsored in part by the Kosciuszko Chair of Polish Studies here at the Institute of World Politics. Without further ado, Mr. Fricke.
Well, thank you,
My name is Benjamin Fricke, and again, as already was said, I was a student here at IWP in 2013, and I'm very happy I'm being given the chance today to speak a little bit about the immigration crisis that we are facing in Europe right now. And my presentation will not solely focus on the immigration crisis that we know from Syria or that comes across the Mediterranean Sea at the moment, but it is a much more multi-layered and a much deeper problem that we see in Europe right now. And just to give you a little bit of an overview, I would like to present a map to you about where the immigration comes from and what the issues really are right now. So I would like to structure this pretty much in three layers of immigration. You have a constant immigration going on already for a while coming from African countries, which also has to do with certain socioeconomic circumstances in Africa, also triggered by some of the agriculture and economic policy by the European Union towards Africa. So you always had, for instance, the borders in Melilla and in Ceuta, which is pretty much fencing off Spain from Africa. And of course you had the crisis in Sudan and Somalia, and right now you also have a famine in Ethiopia. You always had a crisis, and this is what I'm going a little bit more into depth to, because I think this is absolutely underestimated and a problem that we see in Europe today, especially when we talk about inter-European cooperation and political agreements. Because Europe today has a migration of people from Southern Europe to Northern Europe, mainly triggered by bad economic policy, by bad financial policy, and by failed development aid for that country, which is also inherently embedded in the structure of the European Monetary Union and of the European redistribution system within Brussels. And of course, we have the problem of the Eastern refugees now, from Libya and from Syria, as well as we have a lot of migrants from Ukraine going into Poland. So it is a very multi-layered problem that needs to be understood in a global context, and it is not just about the crisis in the Middle East as in Syria or in Libya. These are actually the border protection that have already been built in the north of Africa. Ceuta and Melilla are Spanish enclaves, which pretty much show European wealth. A lot of the Moroccans actually see it as a showcase window for European show-offs, and there are a lot of disputes over those territories too. But for a long time, there has already been immigration going up from Africa into these territories and then across the strait into Spain. So Spain had to face that immigration problem for quite a while already, and the pressure on Spain today isn't actually as great as it is, for instance, on Italy or Greece, or now even through the Balkan route, especially through Hungary or Austria, because they had fenced themselves off for a while now. What I believe in Europe we see right now is also a clash of understanding. It is a mentality clash, and it is a political perception clash. Mainly Germany versus the rest of Europe, but also Eastern Europe versus Western Europe. And what I have called a post-1968 mentality and a post-communist mentality. The post-communist mentality is much less idealistic than what you have in the post-1968 mentality, which still dominates especially German academia, a little bit more left-leaning and a little bit more idealistic, on which also the whole concept of the European Union is built on. As you all know, the European Union was built on the coal and steel community, deriving out of World War II, and then going into ever deeper integration, which really seems to get to its limits at the moment, and especially amplified by the immigration crisis we see. We have countries like Poland, the Czech Republic, Hungary, that are very much struggling with mass immigration because they're also still trying to come out of their post-socialist economy and trying to build their own status in the world. So Eastern European countries also tend to be still a little bit more nationalistic, and I would like to talk with this a little bit closer when I get to the example of Germany, in particular the PEGIDA movement that you see in Germany right now. But the dominant culture and probably ideology that we see applied within Europe and Germany in particular is called the Willkommenskultur, or the welcome culture, which pretty much points that we need to take those people in. We still have that guilt feeling from World War II, and we need to make up for the past, no matter what it's going to cost, how we're going to integrate those people, and most and foremost of all, where the roots of the problems actually lie, because in the countries of origin. And there's a lot of discussion going on, of course, about this. The United States is blamed, inaction is blamed, but it is also the wrong signaling, and most people underestimate this. So the welcome refugee sign, I guess probably most of you have seen this already. You can see it almost glued all over the stations and public places in Europe and in the bigger German cities in particular. And here you see the train station, very typical, where a lot of the refugees arrive. Welcome to Germany and fight Fortress Europe, solidarity with refugees. So there's this huge push going on, and this is where the clash comes from those people who believe we actually need to look at security, we need to look at border checkpoints, we need to see who is actually coming into the country. Because if you look at the actual pictures of the people coming in, if you look at the structure of the people who are being registered, it is not necessarily those stereotypical Syrian families with kids and parents coming to Germany, but there's a lot of young guys in the age of 18 to 25, prime military age. Who knows if they are radicalized, if they were brought in by ISIS or by any other radical group. Those questions aren't publicly being asked, and this is what really causes a lot of concern among the population in Germany and among Europe. And this is also part of the Willkommenskultur, and this is where the detachment primarily comes from between Germans and between German politicians. Angela Merkel is taking selfies with refugees. Of course, that shows a certain way of you're welcome, you should all come to Germany, you should all come to Europe, and you're welcome here. But if you really look at where they go, they don't necessarily want to stay in the Czech Republic or in Hungary. They want to go to the United Kingdom, they want to go to Sweden, and they want to go to Germany, because this is where the benefits are. This is where they believe they can actually find the welfare state they want and the opportunities for them to get ahead. So a lot of this refugee crisis is caused by those wrong incentives. And it is hard, of course, to blame some of these people who are really coming to Europe out of despair. And these are the ones who are always being pushed in the center, in the focus, by the media, by the Willkommenskultur, the welcome culture, and by those people who try to dominate public debate, but of course being blind on the other eye and neglecting all the problems, of course, that come with it. So paradoxically, you also have those. This is, however, what the media rarely covers, and this has been an ongoing problem for the past years. For instance, just in Antwerp, the Jews are deserting because Muslim aggression against Antwerp Jews is becoming more and more prominent. You have a Belgian Jew in shock over beating a 12-year-old girl, and Muslim migrants threw 12 Christians overboard to their death because they were not praying to Allah when they asked God for help when their dinti suffered a puncture. So also refugees don't leave their conflicts behind. Those problems you're bringing in are going to prevail in Europe. And this is what most Europeans have a problem comprehending right now, because we are talking about clashes of religion already in those refugee camps. We're talking about mass beatings. We're talking about rape. But it seems like the authorities haven't really understood what they need to do in order to prevent that. And the more people you come in, the more get in, the more severe the problem actually becomes, because there's also no system to filter, because the Schengen Agreement pretty much opened the borders in Europe, and Merkel is still fighting to keep that open. And alone during the summit in Elmau, during the G summit actually this year, about 7,000 criminals were caught just in the 5 weeks that the borders were partially closed because they needed to retain security in that part of Bavaria. So it shows you the criminal activity that actually the Schengen Agreement and the open borders in Europe fuel. And it is also, of course, a self-understanding of the European Union itself that you need to look at, so what do we really want? But because the political system is not strong enough within Europe to prevent that kind of aggression, to prevent that kind of crime, certain border checkpoints should be reinstated to have a filter function in the current crisis. That does not mean you're closing the borders per se, but it does mean you're going to take security of your own country. And after all, you need to understand the European Union is not a political entity as such. It is an international treaty organization. The European Union doesn't have a constitution. It's based on the Lisbon Treaty. It was based on the Maastricht Treaty before that. And it's actually a bunch of sovereign states that are sharing sovereignty. But if you go on, the idea at the end of the day is the United States of Europe. And of course, that plays into the problem. The current political setup in Europe is not designed to actually fight that problem effectively. And I would just like to give you a little overview of a video. Oops. Why is this not playing? Okay, but I need to get back to the screen, actually. I don't know if I can get the screen on.
That's a really good question. It's going to be a joke question. Do you want me to go get
them? Yeah, it would be nice. I'll show you in just a second. I'm sorry. It's a technology. I will just give you the overview soon. It was actually, these are two videos. One is about refugees at a Hungarian station, and the other one is a reminder of the riots in Paris last year, where you actually saw a clash between the, especially the Jews and the Muslims in Paris. And of course, all that religious fanaticism becomes very apparent. And also, that is an issue that is certainly not talked about in Europe. And to segue a little bit into German politics, Paris has, France has some of the similar problems. I couldn't unfortunately find a lot of English headlines for this, so I'm just going to translate it. The problem we see in Germany right now about the whole debate of immigration comes from a perception by the German politicians and from a perception by the people. For instance, you have Merkel still fighting to keep the borders open all over Europe. It's not negotiable. We cannot close it. We cannot reintroduce checkpoints because we have the Schengen Agreement. You also have Claudia Roth. She is actually a Green Member of Parliament, also Vice President of the German Bundestag. And she actually tries to make Turkey a non-safe country of origin. What that would imply, he would actually open the gates for people from Turkey to come and apply for asylum in Germany as well. And there are already 3.5 million Muslims and Turks living in Germany. The Turks are one of the largest non-German groups in Germany, which of course you also import problems from there. And the Kurds and the Turks have always been fighting in Germany for quite a long time, even in the 90s when German police couldn't really get along with them. And then of course you have that happening, and then you have the German federal president, Joachim Gauck, talking about the dark Germany, the people who hate immigrants, the people who hate asylum seekers. But this is part of the same story, because the people realize politicians don't do enough. The security doesn't really work well. We have that rape, we have that rioting going on. But on the other hand, then you're being put into the Nazi corner. You're being put into the dark side of Germany. And it's always an easy task, especially in Germany, to bring up the 1930s and the Third Reich. And it usually shuts most people up. Other countries have their own issues. However, this is how the German politicians usually do it. And if you look at where people want to go, it is mainly Germany. They have the German flag, they have a picture of Angela Merkel holding up. And so this actually is not that important for some other countries, because they're just gonna sweep them through and they're gonna give them access to Germany and let them through to the German border. And then another thing that is very difficult too. Are these people actually Syrians? Are these eligible asylum seekers? And the black markets for fake Syrian passports is very large. So the German police, the other European police, they find a lot of fake passports from Syria. And they have just now started to get interpreters to interpret the dialect of those Arabic-speaking countries. Are they actually Syrians? This is hard to determine. They should have thought about this much earlier too. But these are all very small steps. And the German police forces, the German security forces, have been warning this about this for a long time. But most people don't actually want to listen to them. And most German politicians still think it is actually all going well, or they don't admit it publicly. Let me like to play to you two links. Oh, they were just there. Okay. Here until the next one. So this is actually a train station. This was filmed by the first response police in Hungary. These people weren't told they were going to be put in camps for now. So they were very frustrated about it, but they also wanted to move on and didn't want to get registered. So this is a scene at an at a train station where the refugees were supposed to continue on to be registered in a camp in Hungary. And of course, you will see some children, but it's mostly young men at a military age, if you will.
There's no
Yes.
Do you know who produced this? Because this has been on the internet and it seems to be the one that's making the rounds.
Yes, this was produced by the first, it's a police team in Hungary. They're like the first ones to respond. They're like a catastrophe. They're also there when you have like a hooligan foot soccer game or something like that. It's like the first response team. Correct. This name here is the name of the first response police. Yes, it's a government video.
Okay.
Yeah. So, most of you have probably seen that video before.
Yeah, I was looking to see the children there.
Yes.
Evidently, I was watching this and I'm looking back over a couple of times, and I noticed that it seems like there's the group that comes out is the young males.
Yes.
But there's a lot of...
Absolutely, yeah.
I mean, the cars are filled, you see, with not necessarily young males.
That's true, yes.
And the young males are actually blocking the access of the food and water.
Yeah.
So again, it's sort of an interesting piece of film.
No, you're definitely right. And this is, again, the problem I was pointing to earlier. Also, if you don't check who these people are, what's their background, try to register them, you don't know whom you're bringing in the country or what their real motive is.
Yeah.
You may have actually a lot of Syrian families coming, but those 2 or 3% that are actual, perhaps trained terrorists, will be the troublemakers. And this is part of intelligence. This is where intelligence should kick in.
Right.
The security network should kick in. But if it's so ideologically...
Yeah,
sure.
Maybe, you know, asking these questions at the appropriate time is beneficial. Why do you think that it has taken Europe so long to come to grips with the issue of as people were coming, because this is, I mean, obviously we're hitting a fever pitch at this point.
Yes.
And this is no great surprise X number of months after this whole exodus has been happening.
Yes.
Why has it taken European countries so long to come to grips with the simplest form of even accessing people as they come in? It's like all of a sudden now it's become such a crisis. They say, oh my God, we've got to do something about it. Well, it's almost like not too late, but it in of itself becomes part of the problem.
Absolutely, and you're definitely right about this. I think it was denial for the most part, and even though intelligence services were warning already years ago, many people didn't want to believe it. German people until today are not well enough informed by media or don't take the time to read enough about it, what is actually going on globally. And of course, after Libya was gone, or Gaddafi was gone, now after the bombing of Syria, things started to pick up more too. And this is now where a clash in Germany again comes into. Whom are we siding with the United States, with Russia? And they didn't want to accept the fact. On the other hand, you also have, Europe is based on the euro currency and on the Schengen agreement. There's not a national identity in Europe. Europe is a continent of nation states. The United States of Europe will always remain a very nice dream, but it will never happen. And Europe is taking itself apart with that. And because they don't acknowledge it is such a diverse continent, there won't be a response appropriate to what is going on right now. And if you drain the South, also Greece or Italy, of their economic prosperity with a completely wrong currency, they can't even depreciate, or they can't keep their social welfare system in place that has been a backbone of that society for a long time, you don't give them the chance to protect their own borders. And you have to recognize that Germany eventually will have to pay for Southern Europe in order to protect their borders. Otherwise, they will fail to do so. And that is all part of a big ideology to some extent, but it was also a denial that I believe that German politicians have been trying to play to the people. There's no real reason why they shouldn't have recognized it earlier.
Aside from the fact that if you started out with the German populace, it has not kept itself abreast of what's been transpiring for a number of years.
Yes.
Not recently.
Yes.
The German politicians, as politicians everywhere, are reluctant to do things. But on the other hand, you do have a government that does have the intelligence, does have the capabilities, and has had the capabilities.
Yes.
Along with other governments who have had capabilities. You gave the example of Spain as why isn't the flow of migrants through there, because there's already been some
yes.
border issues between Spain and Morocco and so on and so forth. Whether that was handled well or not, nevertheless is an example of something that was handled.
Correct.
I'm not suggesting that it was well handled, because I don't know.
And this is what I pointed out earlier too, this what I call the 1968 mentality, that everything should be open was criticized. In 1968, that was a very anti-traditionalist, anti-establishment movement in Germany, all the student riots going on,
yes.
Like the Aquarius movement, if you will.
That.
So, for instance, traditions like the robes in German universities got rid of. A lot of people like Joschka Fischer, the former foreign minister under the red-green government, became foreign minister. They came out of that era. Mm-hmm. And they had a post-nationalistic, open border, and anti-nation approach. And they have, however, always criticized those border fences in Northern Africa. They saw it as an imperial show-off of European power. And they just actually, which is a little paradox, because they've often criticized the European Union for being such a new empire. On the other hand, they haven't really done anything about it. And what they do now is quite the opposite. And it seems like there are some parts of Europe on the verge of going to civil war, if you look at some of these images. So it is a mindset and it is a policy that was made, and the federal police has warned about it, intelligence has warned about it, but they are not the elected officials to make the decision. That is the politicians, and it's a Bundestag. And if no adequate consequences are followed, then you don't get the right action. I mean, Congress can be told a lot of things, but if they do it, that's a completely different story. I'm sorry, sir, you had a question too?
Even Merkel at one time said that multiculturalism is not working.
Yes, I remember that too. Merkel has said a lot of things that were contradictory. And Merkel has changed her opinion many times too. Same with the nuclear power. She tried to get out of nuclear power. Fukushima happened. She changed her opinion radically. She admitted during the beginning of the euro crisis that she doesn't really know what she is supposed to do, because some people tell her this, the other people tell her this. The course she has taken now is to keep the euro alive at all costs. So yes, Merkel has flip-flopped in the past. She has changed her opinion in the past. Some people give credit to her for doing this. Some other people say she flip-flops. Okay, but this is politics too, and this has to do with it. However, the writing on the wall of what was coming was very, very clear. And a lot of Germans are aware of the problem now, but they just never spent enough time or on it, or they couldn't really impact the whole situation as it is unfolding. This is why there's so much frustration going on, and this is what I would like to point out just in a second when I'm going into the PEGIDA movement, which means the patriotic Europeans against the Islamization of the Occident, which pretty much originated in Dresden. Yes?
Sir, I had a question that continues to perplex me. In particular, the Willkommens Kultur.
Yeah.
I can kind of understand that in the generation of the Yorkshire officials, you know, the ones that were either kids during the war, or perhaps that first generation after. But I remember, and this is why it perplexes me, I remember when I was stationed in Germany, it goes back about 30 years ago, in the 80s, already, and the younger generation there, you know, young people like in their 20s then, who obviously would be in the 50s now. But even there, you know, the attitude was, basta, enough. You know, we're tired of this guilt being laid upon us. You know, we're not guilty for the sins of our fathers. And so, you know, I have a hard time understanding why this, you know, this Willkommens Kultur, you know, unless it's really being foisted and forced on people, and there's not a lot of subtle.
That's what it is, yes. It comes from the media, it comes from politics. A lot of people still say that it's enough. We had enough of, there's no inherited guilt. Whatever happened, Germany's paid off money-wise, territorial-wise, and human-wise as well. But every time politicians don't like something, or the media doesn't like something, or something is supposed to be repressed, they get out the Nazi bat, and that is a blackmailing tool for German people. And it still works to some extent, but most people, frankly, probably don't buy into this anymore.
Yeah, I'm just curious, maybe I'm jumping ahead in your speech, and if I am, I apologize, but I'm just kind of wondering, you know, the long-term, or even immediate-term implications of that, as far as the stability of the Merkel government,
yeah.
And whether or not there might be, if you will, a far-right backlash. Obviously, we see PEGIDA, but, you know, are they going to maybe make more traction than they already have? I guess just this last weekend, they had about a 10,000-strong demonstration in Dresden.
Yes. Well, Dresden last week was another important mark for PEGIDA because it was the first anniversary of the PEGIDA movement. Yes, we are jumping a little bit ahead because I'm going to talk about a little bit about the European disintegration process too in context of this, because Germany was actually a latecomer in Eurosceptic movements and in what you called right-wing movements. They're not only right-wing. Syriza in Greece was obviously a left-wing movement, but the right and the left aren't that far apart in many things. That's why the right and the left eventually made a government in Greece. But I'd just like to present this to you quickly. These were the riots in Paris that we saw. No, these were last year. There are riots going on all the time. Some are not that large, but... Thank you. I mean, you get the idea. And here's another fundamental problem. People who see this see a lot of aggression there for whatever the trigger was, and they see a lot of the same people doing this over and over again. And a lot of official media, a lot of politicians don't criticize it as harshly as they would be criticized. If you look at the Pegida movement, they were all Nazis. They all tried to, they're all the new SS coming up and destroying the country. On the other hand, this is hardly ever talked about in public space. It finds very little presence in the public as well. So this is also what frustrates people right now and where the debate evolves around. And again, this is a security aspect. I'm trying to make this as unideologically as possible, but there's a gap of perception. How are we treated as Germans, and how does the government treat us, and what do they have to get away with? I'm not necessarily saying that intelligence and security forces aren't after them, but I'm saying what the actual communication between the government and the people is. So I explained this to you already. And so the consequences of what we have with this, the commons culture, which is, I think, part, a large important part of this, coming from this post-1968 ideology, is mass migration, access to benefits to any welfare state in Europe, and of course the existing welfare state, increasing Islamization, increasing internal tension, and of course a housing problem. They're having a hard time finding places for the people to stay. At the very beginning of the immigration, it was like there are 600,000 people coming. Now we're over 1 million. Their internal numbers already saying there are going to be 5 million just this year. Where are these people going to stay? There are tent camps. They've even said the Oktoberfest in Munich should host the refugees in their tents. So they're here to stay for now. And as it looks right now, most people who don't actually get asylum still stay in Germany. There's not a speedy process of deporting them back to their home country. And one aspect you also have to understand, the Schengen Agreement, wherever you, or the Dublin Agreement in this regard, wherever you jump on European soil, this is where you need to ask for your asylum status. So if people get into Italy, if people get into Spain, that is a country where they need to seek asylum. And here is a problem why Germany was always pretty well off, same as Austria or other European countries. Germany doesn't border the Mediterranean. They never had to deal with the immediate pressure of immigrants. And the German, mostly left-leaning media, mostly left-leaning academics, have always criticized Spain for taking, quote-unquote, such draconic measures like building that fence, as well as Europeans have always liked to criticize the United States building a fence to Mexico. But of course, that this is part of also a failed economic and development policy is a different story. But they don't want to get to the roots of it, and this is what I often see as a problem. Of course, the current momentum we have is help people, try not to let them drown, but also get to the actual basics of the issue that we have in Europe. And here's where Pegida also comes in, because Pegida, I believe, has been a culmination of anger and a frustration to many, many degrees. And I was pondering for a long time why it exactly was the patriotic Europeans against the Islamization of the Occident, especially happening in Dresden, which was the former east of Germany, and that being a part of Germany that has very, very little foreign residents, actually. However, they always say we don't want those circumstances, as in Duisburg-Marxloh, or as in Frankfurt around the train station, that everything looks like you're in little Istanbul already. So, of course, you have that argument, but Pegida is actually gaining traction in other places too, and there are people from all across Germany who sympathize with them. But this also actually means violence-free and united against religious wars on German soil, and they have a 10-point plan where they lay out what they want to do, and of course, they have the ISIS flag, the communist flag, and the swastika thrown into a trash bin. However, they still are going to be branded as right-wing extremists and Nazis. And of course, it is hard to separate who may be a mole, who may be infiltrated, and who is actually a right-wing extremist just participating in Pegida demonstrations. I personally attended one last December to take a look what's actually going on. And just to be sure I don't misjudge, I actually took my grandmother with me, and I wanted to see what she has to say about it. She didn't feel particularly threatened. She didn't feel there was a particularly aggressive crowd. She wouldn't usually go to a soccer game because she wouldn't appreciate the atmosphere. But you can find very normal people there. And of course, you can find some radicals there too, like in any other demonstration as well. Yes?
Hey, Ben, I got a question. You said PEGIDA originated from Dresden. Is there something about the political culture in Dresden? Because if I recall back in 1989,
yes,
that was the epicenter of the anti-communist movement in East Germany. It was Dresden or Leipzig, I can't remember. But what was very interesting was those were the areas that actually did not get German television because they were behind the hills.
Yes.
And they were they would never get it, but that was actually the epicenter of the anti-communist movement in East Germany.
Well, yeah, Dresden, it was in Dresden, yes, but also in 1989, Leipzig was a city of the revolution, and that's where the people flocked to the churches. And yes, Dresden was called the Valley of the Knowledgeless because they had a hard reception, and the Eastern German regime tried to pretty much cut them off. But yeah, Dresden always retained a certain a culture of conservatism and of a tradition to some extent. And they always had a little bit of a different spirit, of course, than Leipzig too. There's a Ligida, which is Leipzig part, which is also probably the second largest. But they also have a different spirit. And Leipzig is a much more left-leaning city. You have the anti-fascist movement, the Black Bloc, throwing bottles and rocks. If you go to some parts of Leipzig, you know you're in a very alternative quarter. Dresden doesn't have that so much. So yes, there is a political culture gap between Dresden and Leipzig as well. But you're right, those were the two cities where the initial 1989 movement started too. And I was going to talk about that in a little bit too, because the culture in Germany is the post-communist culture here, and people see a lot of propaganda going on and the same pattern going on, what they have perhaps seen at the end of the Cold War in the East German regime. And many people are reminded of East German politicians when they see Angela Merkel speak, because she was brought up in the former East of Germany, and some people, actually I'm going to continue this, so some people actually think she has a certain dictatorship about this, and so these are things you see. Merkel, the new swastika as a euro sign, so the Fourth Reich, and you have questions, Merkel must go. And very interesting too, the National Stasi Agency. This is how Merkel is sometimes depicted, because she is seen as this Eastern German melange from that time and a puppet of the United States government, which of course there's a lot of deception in there. There's a lot of propaganda in there. But this is what people perceive her to be, and this is how people display her. The IM, that's called inoffizieller Mitarbeiter, an unofficial employee for the German, for the East German Stasi, and apparently her name was supposed to be Erika, and so you see the connection to In God We Trust and I Am Erika We Trust, that she's a puppet of the United States. But a lot of this is actually used a little bit, in my impression, by European politicians in order to cover up their own deficits in politics and use the United States as a scapegoat for their own deficiency and say, I'm not responsible for this, this all comes from the United States. So the PEGIDA demonstration is actually using this flag a lot, which is the Joseph Vermeer flag, which is a flag that was designed in 1944 by Catholic Joseph Vermeer, who was involved in the Stauffenberg attempt to assassinate Hitler. And it shows the Phillips cross, reminding you of the Norwegian flag. And it uses the German colors, black, red, and gold. And the three bars that you have in today's German colors was a little bit touchy at that time, because it represented also the failure of the Weimar Republic. So he tried to come up with something new, and he chose the Phillips cross, apparently because he was a member of the Center Party, which was a Catholic party in Germany. So you have that going on. And again, we just talked about this. You have the two largest ones pretty much in Dresden and in Leipzig, but also these are anti-PEGIDA demonstrations, the Willkommenskultur, so to speak, clashing there. However, looking at a map of Europe, this is where PEGIDA demonstrations happened anywhere else. So you can see other countries have traction too, within Poland, even Bulgaria, Spain, France, and also the United Kingdom. And the interesting thing about the PEGIDA branding is you can really replace it with any other word too. So it pretty much sounds in every language very similar, and it's a very good name to keep in mind. So this goes on into what we have in the European Union today. We have stopped the Euro state, so that anger just kind of channels in there. And especially the British are very Eurosceptical. And this goes back to your question about the right wing and perhaps about the new conservative movements. In Germany, it's called the Alternative für Deutschland, the Alternative for Germany, which was initially founded by an economics professor and who was very Eurocritical. He was a member of the CDU for many years. However, he decided to found his own party. He actually is not a member anymore. He left. And PEGIDA and AfD in Saxony especially are cooperating pretty well with each other. That is also part now of that immigration crisis. So it does fundamentally change internal German and European politics. You always had the Front National in France with Marine Le Pen. You had, of course, UKIP with Nigel Farage as their leader. You have Syriza. They've lost a little bit of traction right now. They've seemed to play the game now. And of course, it seems in general, the more the EU integrates, the worse the problem become, the more Europe disintegrates. Catalonia just had an election and they pretty much voted for independence. At least they made the election look like it. Scottish National Party would probably also win a majority right now, and Scotland would secede. So we see a movement like this all over Europe, and they're gaining traction. The FPÖ in Austria, also a Eurosceptic party, the Lega Nord in Italy. So a lot of those people are more and more focusing on it. And this is another very important aspect that you need to consider when you have this massive immigration coming to Europe. These are unemployment numbers, youth unemployment numbers. 56% in Spain, 73% in Greece. That is a very, very high number of youth unemployment. And the euro is one of the reasons why those countries are still so indebted and why they're still economically weak, because they don't have a tool to appreciate or to devalue their own currency. Of course, there are a lot of ideological arguments about it. The euro is an ideological project. It is not an economically founded project. It was to unite Europe. And one reason why the Schengen is so important is because the EU really is just based on the Schengen agreement and on the euro. This is pretty much what gives it identity. The constitution was rejected by the Netherlands and by France, and the Lisbon Treaty was then put in place, which reflects that constitution that was rejected in the first place to a large extent. Just to give you a little overview here again, alone in Portugal, about 10,000 people leave Portugal every month. So you have an internal migration crisis too. So what are you going to do with those millions of people going into Europe right now? Plus, you already have a huge number of unemployment in your own southern European countries that already are pushing up north. You're literally destroying the southern European cultures and southern European countries. You're creating a lost generation of young people in Europe. And this for an ideology that actually also has an impact on your surroundings. We've all heard about it, the New World Order, always is a little bit mystified, but this also, the European Union, and part of it all comes out of this. This is my own interpretation of this. The New World Order is an international system of supra and multinational organizations for global governance, which are not accountable to any democratic process or national jurisdiction. You probably heard about the subsidiarity principle in Europe. You give powers to a certain level and you take it back if you needed to. You have the International Monetary Fund, you have the World Bank, you have the United Nations. But we talk about global governance. This is unaccountability. And if you play this game wrong, the people are going to be the victims of that issue. And this is also another reason why so many in Europe are being frustrated right now. And they see that their politicians don't really do anything. So you have rapidly rising numbers of unemployment. This would be my prediction for Europe. A massive increase in government and welfare spending in the short run. What also was seen, we have the Syrians coming to Germany now and to Europe. They are going to replace a demographic problem. So I sometimes think there's a little bit of a system behind it too, because we replace people or we put them into jobs nobody else wants to do, but not everyone who's coming is always well educated or has that intention of really working there. And many of them are actually not able to read and write either. You have internal destabilization of the European countries, a disintegration and more infighting between the European Union members, and a loss of innovation and investment. So I strongly believe that this current migration crisis in Europe is going to be a catalyst for the disintegration of the European Union. And it really needs a reform in order to survive. Just to give you one aspect here, Milton Friedman said this about the euro in the 90s already, before it was introduced. Europe's common market exemplifies a situation that is unfavorable to a common currency. It is composed of separate nations whose residents speak different languages, have different customs, and have a far greater loyalty and attachment to their own country than to the common market or idea of Europe. Despite being a free trade area, goods move less freely than in the United States, and so does capital. And he also continued, the drive for the euro has been motivated by politics and not economics. And this is also the point I was making earlier. It is an ideological construct, and for that reason, it is so hard for European politicians to actually take appropriate actions against the immigration crisis, because that means reform. And as soon as the European Union starts to reform, it will change fundamentally, and it will probably collapse because it was not built on a lot of democratic legitimacy. And the only answer that European politicians always come up with is, well, the Europe as we have it doesn't work, so we need more Europe. We need much deeper integration. We need a fiscal integration. We need a European treasury. We need a European army. But it already starts with very basic things. In France, the military is part of the internal security backbone. Germany, the Bundeswehr, or the military, can't even be used internally. When there was a flood in Hamburg in the 1960s, Helmut Schmidt ordered the Bundeswehr to rescue people. That was technically against the Constitution, against the basic law. So there are already those little things that are mentally clashing in Europe. And of course, the euro as an ideological project. I don't want to go into this too much, but there are some reasons why, economically speaking, the euro wasn't such a great idea after all. However, you do have politicians talk about this, and this new world order, this new treaty organization, all comes out of it. And even Helmut Schmidt said that he believes Europe is at the verge of a revolution. It's becoming more and more discontent. And that immigration crisis, based on the structural immigration from Africa, you also have to understand that the European Common Agricultural Policy had a very devastating impact on African agriculture. Europe spends about 40% of its budget on agricultural subsidies. It exports chicken, for instance, to Africa. Like Ghana tried to put tariffs on European chicken. The World Bank and the IMF almost nailed Ghana for this and told them you won't get any more loans. So that really prevented them from putting tariffs on top of it. While the European Union has high tariffs and they're internally massive subsidizing the agricultural products. Of course, there's a famine in Ethiopia right now, and African agriculture is insufficient to some extent. But then you should put your development aid where exactly it needs to go. This might be maybe better fertilizers, better crops, help them put irrigation system in place that actually help you grow crops better and more sustainably, but don't intentionally destroy their agriculture with such type of policy, because this is part of the structural and systemic refugee crisis. And another reason what I've been arguing for, Europe needs to be ready to also consider military intervention as well. When UN Resolution 1973 was passed in the UN, Germany abstained. France, Britain, and the United States voted for it, and that already shows, too, there's a gap between European foreign policy. So if they can't even agree on the most basic things, how is there going to be a European foreign minister or European high commissioner, whatever you want to call that person, to design a European foreign policy that can prevent such a mass migration? And Libya was a close ally against the refugees with Italy. Italy was actually kind of happy to have Gaddafi there because he bordered his 1,200-mile coast. And Libya today is one of the largest migration camps in the world. And Westerwelle, who was German foreign minister at that time, categorically excluded the stationing of troops in Libya. The United States didn't put troops there. They had other stuff to do. France didn't put troops there, and Britain didn't put troops there either. Of course, it was going to be a system that was going to fail, and now they're trying to make it over in nutshells across the Mediterranean. And what Germans also have a problem with, in particular when it comes to military intervention, that is that they don't want it. They always saw that during the Cold War they were safe, but that was to a large extent the protection umbrella of the United States. And now they put the hopes on Russia finally getting ISIS under control and stopping the movement of people, as well as they always have thought, well, if something is coming up, the United States will handle it. The mentality of military intervention in Germany is literally not there. And this is, again, out of the World War II experience. And it's been so hammered into the people's minds that they've forgotten about their own heritage of Bismarck, Clausewitz, and of any kind of military strategy. That doesn't mean you go to war, but it means you have to have a security system in place that protects your population. And Europe would probably be better off if Germany was more willing to actually go out internationally and actually go out with its European partners under a different paradigm than it does right now in the context of the European Union. So I just have some suggestions for reforms. I think what we need to do in the short term is we need to reinstate border controls across Europe. Doesn't mean you close borders, but it means you actually keep the flow of people checked, and you need to register those people coming into Europe. You need to set up reception camps in Northern Africa. We are still under international law. We still obey the Geneva Convention. You can still apply for asylum, but that doesn't mean you have to come illegally and under the great threat of your life to Europe at any cost. So let them come there and check the application in Northern Africa. You need speedy asylum assessment and deportation processes if they're actually denied. You need to intensify the use of intelligence and fight human traffickers, because the human trafficking business is also one of the large economic benefactors from that current situation. You need to stop creating a false image of the commons culture, of the welcome culture, and you also need to be ready to use military intervention if necessary. You have to acknowledge the EU as a treaty organization and not a political entity, also very important for the United States. There's this famous quote by Henry Kissinger, if I call Europe, whom am I going to call? Well, you probably have to call 27 different countries, even more if you actually want to talk to them. And there are more countries who will probably join Germany or France if they take action, but this is just how diplomacy works sometimes. You have to invest in African countries, and this is interesting too, and this is an aspect I believe is much neglected. When the border conflicts between Libya and Chad were going on in the late 80s, Chad had a pretty good functioning army. I mean, they got assistance from France and the United States. However, they kicked out Gaddafi eventually. So why not use those countries that actually have a standing army to fight Boko Haram or to fight ISIS and not actually support those terrorist organizations that just go completely nuts afterwards, like the Taliban, and then exploit it for their own religious or fanatic beliefs? You need to support those African countries in the fight for terrorism. I think you do have to think about dismantling the euro in a peaceful way eventually, using a gold standard, using a parallel currency for a while, but the euro as it works right now is destroying Europe. And you need to reform the EU into, in my opinion, a similar setup to what the Hanseatic League was, a cooperation of states and cities that protect each other if necessary, but you don't interfere in any other internal politics too much. So as you can see, the immigration crisis in Europe is really a culmination of many factors. The internal European crisis, the structural crisis in Africa, and the crisis that we have with Libya and Syria, where you now pretty much have put the spark on the gunpowder barrel that really triggered a mass of people coming to Europe. I would like to leave it with this for now and perhaps give you some more time for questions. Yes.
On the last point, you mentioned the dismantling of the euro.
Yes.
How, because I'm not, other than using the euro all the time when I travel, how does it differ from, let's say, using the dollar, for instance, in the United States? Something, a Coca-Cola in New York costs more than a Coca-Cola in, let's say, Alabama.
Sure.
Okay? So the same dollar buys you less Coca-Cola in New York than it does in Alabama.
Yes.
So I always assume that the same euro, if it changes, you might get you get less Coca-Cola in Germany than you do in Spain. Beyond
yes.
that, what are the differences? Because how does that dismantling the euro per se make a difference? I don't understand.
Yes, well, that has to do with the monetary union and the fiscal union we always talk about. The United States is a coherent country. You have one constitution, you have a redistribution system, you have federal funds being distributed all across the United States through welfare, through healthcare, and you speak pretty much the same language, and you share a common culture, and you have one president sitting in the White House, and you have one Congress making the laws. You have 19 countries today, well, but you have 19 countries today in Europe that pretty much still are responsible for their own debt. And what we've seen now is you had a bailout of countries over and over again. After the Civil War in the United States and the War of Independence, Alexander Hamilton socialized the debt as well. And that was the last time that happened. Every other country, every other state in the United States is pretty much independent, and there's no bailout clause for the United States as well, which is technically in place for Europe too, but it didn't really happen because Greece got a lot of money, Italy got a lot of money, and the banks were the problem as well. So what happened during the euro was introduced, especially the euro was introduced as book money in 1999, and it was then introduced as paper money in 2002. So what happened, all the other countries that always were based on inflation pretty much, like the lira or the franc or the peseta in Spain, you had a decrease in interest rates. So those countries lived off of debt because they were all of a sudden so happy they had German interest rates. But a glass of olives is not a BMW you export. So by taking up more and more loans, your interest rates become more and more with time, even though they may be lower than they were 10 years before. So what happened then, a lot of those faulty loans, a lot of that mentality was still taken over. And these countries didn't have a chance to appreciate or depreciate their currency. So it meant social cuts. You couldn't use in Germany the Deutschmark to appreciate anymore, which is actually the biggest social dividend you can get. This is the biggest welfare program, because if you buy more, or if you're able to buy more abroad, you have cheap vacation, you have cheap gas, and you can actually afford something for your productivity. So those countries got more and more into debt. And the best comparison to explain this is after reunification in 1990, the Deutschmark was introduced in the former east of Germany, and it pretty much flattened the economy of the former east of Germany because it was too strong. The products just didn't have the value for the money, or very little, so they had to let millions of people go, literally. And that is a problem with the euro, too. In Germany, we've established a huge transfer system between the federal states, and the east still is a receiving area because the Deutschmark actually killed that economy, and you have to start from scratch. But there were about 16, 17 million Germans living in the east, and about 62 million living in the former west. So the ratio was much different than it is today. Depreciation and appreciation of a currency is to make it easier for you to actually be also easier on your own people in terms of social benefits. You have to cut wages, you have to cut retirement, and you're going to lose economy if you don't have a currency which is actually appreciating or depreciating. What you need in Europe now is either complete integration in a welfare state, or you need to go back to the currencies that the countries can actually export according to the market value. Because nobody in Turkey is going to buy a glass of Greek olives because the Turkish olives are much cheaper. So they're overpriced. And for German products, they're still underpriced. What Germans didn't pay attention to, also when the euro was introduced, the German economy was expanding rapidly. But of course, that lost market shares for the other countries. And if you, by cheap credit, subsidize that consumption, of course you're driving the other country's businesses out of business, and you're expanding your own business based on other people's credit. And this is what we're facing right now. And this will continue this way because they have no chance of actually recovering. And if you look at some numbers, some statistics, of course they sometimes disappear too, but 10,000 Portuguese leaving Portugal every month, this is a big house number. This is a big problem. So the euro does have a deep economic impact on the stability and the economic health of southern European economies.
So then it would actually require a whole dismantling of Europe, or does it require a change in the fiscal management of the way that the euro is utilized? There still is the issue of, again, I'm using this very simplistic example of, a can of Coke in New York City is more expensive than the can of Coke for New York City, New York State, than it is a can of Coke in
But in the people from Alabama can move to New York City freely and don't have any problem working there either. If you're people in New York City, maybe from Alabama originally, they can move to the capital, they can move to where they want to go, and they can work there. That is a problem with what Milton Friedman said too.
But that happens the same thing in Europe, because in Schengen...
But not to such an extent.
Within the system, you can move. For instance, I have a friend whose daughter is a young lawyer in England, maybe be to go and practice someplace else.
Sure, but do you speak French or German instantly? I mean, the problem.
Anything else. Yeah, okay. There's the language issue. Yeah.
Yes, so you have the language issue, the culture.
I don't know. Our southern dialects sometimes can be a little.
Well, sure, but the problem is people here move. As he mentioned it too, Milton Friedman. For instance, here I didn't finish it, but the aim has been to link Germany to France so closely to make a future Eurowar impossible, and to set the stage for federal United States of Europe. I believe that the adoption of the euro would have the opposite effect. It would exacerbate political tension by converting divergent shocks that could have been readily accommodated by exchange rate changes into divisive political issues. Europe doesn't have the same system as the United States.
Right.
Capital and people don't move as freely for obvious reasons. And there are other traditions and other cultures. There are even discrepancies between how to run a welfare state. And if you also have these people coming in now, Germany having already a demographic decline, you're putting a lot of stress on the welfare state. And it's also unfair and morally irresponsible to drain those European economies in the south with the wrong currency. Yes, I do understand that things are more expensive in New York than Alabama. Things in Munich are more expensive than in Berlin too. But Germans have never questioned the transfer system within Europe. The idea about the European Union was never to burden for the debt of southern European countries, or any European country for that matter. And it's also never been the intention to have a united retirement, healthcare, or pension system. Mm-hmm. So you have to actually completely change the structure of Europe. You have to literally dissolve the European countries. And we've reached that limit right now because this is what people don't want. So this is why the euro will also not work. You can keep it alive artificially. And as you look to history, look at the Latin Monetary Union, at the Scandinavian Monetary Union, or the Austro-Hungarian, the Austro-German Monetary Union, they all failed because of political and especially economic divergence, because they were not able to or willing to bridge this. Yes, sir. Correct. That's absolutely correct.
Another bottom line is, like you say, Germany is the one writing the check.
Yes.
You know, essentially.
Yes. Germany will have to pay either by cash or by credit or by taking those people and paying for them. This is going to be the consequence of it.
So let's say tomorrow that you wave the magic wand and no more euro. Everybody's back to Deutsche Mark.
Of course, there would be shocks. I'm not denying this. It probably would be a different process than just saying, okay, we're all going to pay with Deutschmark or a franc tomorrow again. It may be a time of parallel currencies. You could even keep the euro as the former EQ, as a gold standard in Europe. So it could be a conversion currency again. But if Greece had probably left the eurozone, it would be much better off now. Of course, you can't just say, okay, you know, I left the euro, go and do your own thing. They could have still gotten support and business, but they at least can export stuff that people would buy, because the market still determines by price and not by solidarity. I mean, this is not, it's economics, it's not a welfare system. And that's what it was about, free trade, not political union. Yes?
Can we go back to the 10,000 people a month leaving
yes.
Portugal?
Sure.
What kind of demographics are they? Is this a brain drain on Portugal? And they're losing
of course.
Or is this the people that are unemployed and good riddance to them?
Well, it's both. It's unemployed, mostly good, well-educated people. And what shows, too, is people who are better educated are more willing to leave the country as well. And if you take a look here, every month an average of 10,118 people depart, mainly to France, Luxembourg, Switzerland, the UK, and the former Portuguese colony, Angola. I mean, if Angola is already more popular than Portugal is, that should give you something to think about in terms of the internal economic structure of the country.
Is that equivalent to people moving west in the US, finding open lands and the possibility?
I don't think it really comes out of the manifest destiny spirit or adventurism that the United States really coined. And of course, the United States government, look at the Homestead Act, et cetera, they were trying to colonize the west of the United States too, to bring light to the dark. This is out of pure necessity. People can't find jobs. The government is unwilling and unable to pay the welfare. They're cutting. I mean, look at how many cuts the Greek people had to take over the last years. They're the ones actually suffering. the bailout money never really arrived at the people's place. The bailout money went to the banks. So the regime has not actually helped the people, except that it boosts credit for the euro regime, except that it boosts credit for many years, and now those people are actually paying for it. Yes?
You essentially have the southern countries being gutted of their intelligentsia,
yeah.
of their brain.
Yes.
What is going to happen? What's going to happen in this area? Is it going to be...
You, as I said, you're probably destroying the culture and the heritage of these countries. You're letting it go into chaos, and it's maybe it's repopulated by the new immigrants. Who knows? I'm very doubtful a lot of these people are going back once they've found a foothold in Northern Europe or even the United States. I did an internship in Berlin for a while. I was one of two Germans in the whole office. Everyone else was from Greece, Italy, or Spain. I mean, it was unbelievable how many young people tried to go to Northern Europe, Germany, or try to come to Canada, the United States, Australia, New Zealand, just to find a better life. And if you could correct it by just a simple act of rational fiscal and economic policy, why not do it? But the euro has become such an ideology that people are frantic about it, and Merkel would do anything to keep it alive.
It's become a big experiment.
It has, yes. But like 70 currency unions without political unions that existed, most likely going to fail. It's on the best path to it. And the support for the EU has been decreasing for many years, as we can see with the rise of anti-euro and euroskeptic parties in Europe too. And that's an issue that needs to be talked about. And also very important for the United States, because what will the United States get from an ally that is politically hating each other and that is actually infighting all the time? A destabilized Europe cannot be the intention of American foreign policy either. Yes?
Yeah, so really what's happening is the arc of instability is going from the Middle East into Europe.
Correct. Again, that's what I say. In order for Greece to secure its border, Germany and the rest of Europe must pay, because they don't have the financial credibility anymore to protect their own borders. There was a Mare Nostrum program, which was a sea rescue program across the United States, across the Mediterranean, mainly run by Italy. They stopped that because they didn't have enough funding anymore. They replaced it with a program called Triton. And there was a much cheaper program. It just bordered the Italian coast, and the Mare Nostrum was pretty much covering the whole of the Mediterranean to save people from drowning and looking for this. This just had to be stopped because there was no more money. Of course, there is a European border agency called Frontex, but this is still just a collection of nation-state units, and they need to be able to cooperate. And the attention, especially militarily, hasn't been so much focused lately on the Mediterranean, but has been more focused on the Middle East. We had afraid of Syria, of Russia, etc., of Ukraine especially too.
Well, of Angela Merkel, there was great concerns about the roles, not specifically about this, but in a number of different things. Actually, one was about Ukraine, and so you pointed out, for instance, there was the cartoon with her, and you know, that one,
the pig ears.
And I'm sort of curious, what is the root of the belief that the U.S. is totally Angela Merkel? And I've already, you know, as I said, I'm not saying that there isn't a lot of support, I mean, in a lot for a lot of things, but it's not like, where does that come from?
Well, it comes from... Well, first of all, there are a lot of conspiracy theories going around. There's still the claim Germany still is a dominion of the United States. The occupation statute after World War I has never really been lifted. Germany is a limited company. It's actually run out of Washington, D.C. So you have all that kind of stuff going on. And of course, there's a lot of propaganda and deception in there. And this particular one came out of Merkel tolerating the NSA spying on Germans. However, as everyone should have known who's been dealing with intelligence, the German intelligence services did the same, the French did the same. I always like to quote the Victoria Nuland incident where the Russian intelligence service was listening, fuck the EU, pardon me. But this all comes out of the same idea, and if those countries didn't do the intelligence right, you would be concerned as well. But this pretty much means, why did Merkel not do anything about it, even though she knew the NSA was spying on German citizens, was reading the emails, and was listening to her cell phone? So that goes a lot into this. And this is why they think Merkel would be just a puppet run by Obama or by whoever is in charge in the United States. Yes, sir? No, okay. Does it answer your question?
Yeah. I mean, none of these things are black or white. They're this, you know, full range of grays.
Of course. And I consider myself a transatlanticist. However, I'm not particularly pro-Euro or pro-unconditional European integration that can exist too. That's why I'm wearing the German-American flag and not the European-American flag. So everyone needs to see it. I also think that the retaining the democratic right of each individual country and populace is very, very important. We've gone through that process. We've gone through this past before. Václav Klaus, the former president of the Czech Republic, pointed this out. We've left one regime under the Soviet Union, and we're going into the next one, the European Union. And why don't people just finally step up for themselves and take their actual right of self-determination and live their own democracy? And the Poles have experienced a lot of the same things. They have retained now a certain sensitivity towards what's going on in Brussels, because the only thing it really does, it acquires more and more power, and it wants more and more decentralization. During the whole Euro bailout, there was a rescue mechanism established under the ESM, the European Stability Mechanism. It's run by a board of governors that is unaccountable, and even when they get out of it, and they can't really talk about it, and they have the right to draw the money they need from the European governments. So there is no more democratic process. This is becoming what also then seems to be more and more this new world order approach. It's always mystified new world order, God who runs it, the Freemasons, the Bilderbergs or whatnot. Well, it's an institutionalization of supranational powers, of treaties. This is what it really means. Yes?
This is why Denmark in England, or the UK, are so many genius, and they didn't buy into the Euro.
Yes.
And they had the opt-out.
Yes. Oh, the Dublin Agreement. Yes, yes, that's correct. The Dublin Agreement is pretty much what I explained earlier. If you arrive in Spain or Greece, this is where you get registered and this is where you first apply for asylum. So what the EU now tried to do is get a quota, but that didn't work out too well. And a lot of Eastern European countries are against this. I mean, Viktor Orban, he was heavily criticized. He said, Hungary is a Christian country and we don't want that many Muslims coming in here. And of course, a lot of people in Western Europe didn't like that too much. And Poland is very similar in that aspect. They're very Catholic and they would like to retain that. Religion in Germany doesn't really play such a big role anymore, and a lot of people are indifferent about religion. So for them, it's this Willkommenskultur. Well, religion is everyone else's business and you just leave me alone with it. But you see that this is a continuous process. School in North Rhine-Westphalia just forbade the burqa and the jihad, so they don't walk around in totally covered up anymore, because it is more and more becoming a problem. And there is rape, there is crime, and you just need to look at the statistics, you need to do a little bit of research, and you will find that this is an issue that is going to be socially very, very important in Europe in the month and years to come. Because this will alter the foundation of Europe as a community and of each individual state in Europe.
I was interested in a comment you made early in your talk about the German people being less knowledgeable than they should, maybe under, I don't know, I don't know the right word, because I read Der Spiegel to get information that is not available through American sources.
Yes.
That we receive. So I'm going to German sources for information.
And no, that is fine. I mean, I'm not saying that German media per se is doing a bad job, but there are certain things that they don't talk about. You have to actually look for them. And the public media was under a lot of critique about many issues, and even they have apologized for some misinformation before, especially in the Ukrainian conflict. And what most people are also upset about is you pay pretty much a fee to receive public television, and they don't like that too much. There's a word that they brought out, which was used in World War II before, but now comes out. It's called lying press or Lügenpresse. It also comes from the PEGIDA movement, pretty much, claiming that system-conform information are being passed on. And because people think or feel a lot is going this way, and they have experienced it, especially in the former east of Germany before, this is why Dresden and Leipzig are some of those hot spots, because the propaganda reminds them a lot of what was going on at the end of the Cold War, especially when the East German regime was cornered and everything is going well, the euro is fine, we're all recovering, but nothing really happens. It's just this gap between reality and what the media tells you. And if you really look into this, not everything they tell you is wrong, but sometimes what they don't tell you is more important than what they do tell you. Correct.
Are there any credible private media outlets?
There are private media outlets, and funny enough, there's actually a public media outlet too in Germany, which I personally like. I want to advertise. It's called Phoenix. But the most critical and the most interesting interviews are aired at like 11 p.m. and 3 a.m. in the morning. But you wouldn't see it on prime time in Germany. Of course, you wouldn't see it on prime time at the 8 o'clock news and the Tagesschau that comes on ARD or anything that you have that time. It's always interesting to see a more in-depth discussion so late at night, and it's also the timing. So people in Germany actually look for more and more alternative news sources these days, and just read the blogs. What you read in the newspaper articles and what you read in the blogs, I'm not saying that every blogger is always well informed, but the reality that people describe for themselves is a lot different from what you get to hear sometimes from a politician or from some of the media outlets. And again, I'm not a media expert, but when I go and just read the blogs and when I go and read the media, I can see a difference too, to be quite frank. It always depends on the article and the news outlet I read. I try to be unbiased. I mean, I sometimes read very left-wing magazines, sometimes right-wing magazines, sometimes just the mainstream. But I also have a different worldview about explaining it sometimes. Because I consider myself more of a Bismarckian real politician and try to look at these aspects. And of course,
I think that's a very cool statement.
And that is not something you would find in Germany a lot these days anymore. And I'm actually grateful for the Institute that they've brought up some of my German heritage here more so than I would have ever learned at a German university. So. You know what, I actually don't know. I don't know if Al Jazeera, I don't think so. And I watch Al Jazeera English sometimes. I know Russia TV had a German outlet, but I don't think Al Jazeera does. But please don't quote me on that one. I have to check. But I mostly watch Al Jazeera, if I do, in English.
Russland heute?
Russland heute. So you do have Russian news in Germany too, yes. So, pardon my lack of knowledge there, but I really don't know. Any other questions? Okay.
Thank you so much.
I hope you enjoyed it.